Hey guys, Pete here. Gonna do a Game of Thrones bonus video today. Even though, as we all know, episode 6 has leaked and a lot of people have seen it, I'm gonna do what I did last time that an episode leaked. I'm gonna stick to my regular schedule of videos I had planned. And I'm going to implore all of you that have seen it not to spoil it for everyone who's waiting in the comments of this video. It's out there, it's available if people want to go watch it, so commenting about what happened in it is not doing anybody any favors. In fact, it's being a shit and just ruining something that other people are waiting for, so please don't do that. So last week, when I did my top moments, the one thing I was talking about that it was really kind of exciting at the end of the last episode was this band of people that are all together north of the wall. I was thinking of them as a dream team as far as based on who is involved, but I think the name the Magnificent Seven is the one that's the most popular, so we can go with that. But what I got most excited about was thinking at the end we got a hint of this, just how none of these people would ever be together if it wasn't for this crazy situation. Like we saw Gendry say, "You tried to sell me to a red witch." We saw Tormund get upset when he found out Jorah was a Mormont. So on and so forth. So I'm going to look at all that stuff, why this makes this an interesting gang, and just really celebrate these characters because who knows who's actually going to come back out of them. Somebody's going to die. Maybe several people are going to die. So let's give them all a look before this all goes down. So everyone's together because of Jon Snow. I think it's kind of a ridiculous idea what they're doing, going to catch a wight, but that is where we are, so there's no reason to really break that down. I mean, this is what it is. They don't have photographs. I guess that it would have made more sense for them to send someone from King's Landing to just see it instead of trying to bring it back, but this is the way it went. It sets up a grand adventure with some really colorful characters, so let's look at those characters. Jon, we know, is only really worried about fighting the Night King. This is his major priority in life. He feels like humanity and the fate of men is hanging in the balance. And for all intents and purposes, he's probably right. Jon ended up going on this, even though Jorah volunteered to do it himself, because he knows more about the undead than anyone else. He has a Valyrian sword, so that's a good thing too, because he can actually kill White Walkers. And even though he is a reluctant hero, we pretty much know he's not going to die, so that's pretty safe, I'd say. The next guy on the roster is Gendry. He's the last bastard that's left from Robert Baratheon. If you don't remember, Cersei went through a purge where she killed off a lot of the bastards because Robert had quite a few of them. We haven't seen him for a long time because Melisandre was using him for his blood and Davos was afraid that he was going to be killed. So he sent him off in a rowboat. After he came back into our story in the last episode, he kind of injected himself in this. Like most people, I figured that Davos wanted to bring him back because of his smithing skills, and that would come in handy. And Davos did tell him to conceal his identity, but he quickly disregarded that when he met Jon, and that led to him volunteering to go up north. I also mentioned Jorah, the third member of our crew. He's been on the run from Westeros for the entire series because the man who raised Jon Snow, Ned Stark, wanted to execute him for the crime of slaving. He eventually found his way to Daenerys and he served her. But she found out that he had worked with the crown for a pardon, so she didn't trust him. He got grayscale. Eventually, she sent him off, and he got it cured. So now he's back, and he wants to do whatever he can, so he volunteered to go. The next guy is Sandor Clegane, and we call him the Hound. He was sort of lost after he was almost killed by Brienne in their one-on-one combat, where Arya finally got away from him. He met Ian Shane's character last season, and that sort of brought him around, and he ran into the Brotherhood Without Banners. He's never been a believer in gods or magic, but this year we saw him have a vision in the flame. This is primarily why he's there. He doesn't have anything to gain one way or the other. He's not fighting for anyone at this point. So really, his whole seeing a vision and going north of the wall is about redemption of his character, I guess you could say. We have Tormund Giantsbane, the wildling that everybody kind of likes as a comedic character. He's basically the leader of the wildlings now, I guess you could say, since Mance was executed, maybe not in official capacity, but they, after Hardhome, they seem to follow what he says. Being a wildling on, you know, puts him on the outside of all of these guys because, of course, people from Westeros look down on the wildlings. But he understands Jon's perspective that this is important because he's lived north of the Wall. So he's down for the cause of saving mankind from the threat. We've got Beric Dondarrion. We first met him when Ned sent him out to kill the Mountain. He's come back into the story several times as the Brotherhood. He's actually died 6 times, in case you forgot, and Thoros has brought him back. He's a fanatic, I guess you could say, when it comes to the Lord of Light. He's a fervent supporter of that religion. He says that he's not doing so well each time that he comes back. We learned that when the Hound first met back up with him. But he's there because he believes that he's alive for a reason. He dies, the Lord of Light brings him back, and there must be a reason for that. He doesn't know what it is. We also have Thoros of Myr, who is Beric's right-hand man, more or less. He's the last guy on our roster. He was a Red Priest. I don't know if you could call him that anymore. He's a heavy drinker. I mentioned this in several videos. You know, he first came to King's Landing to convert people to the faith of the Red God, but he basically just sat around and drank and all that kind of stuff. But he had a big change in direction when he found out he was able to bring Beric back to life. So he's on the same kind of plane as Beric. He's on this mission because there must be a reason. The god R'hllor, the Red God, must have a reason to keep him around. So what's really the most interesting thing about all these people is that they're mostly opposed to each other for different reasons, good reasons you could say, and it makes for a really interesting dynamic. Jon is the one outlier here. No one really has any problems with Jon, other than maybe Jorah, because of his unrequited love for Daenerys. There was a little bit of foreshadowing in that in episode 5 where we kind of saw that both men were sort of checking each other out, but this is going to be hitting a lot harder for Jorah once he realizes she's about to fall for Jon Snow for real. Jorah may also have a problem with the fact that Jon's carrying around his family's ancestral Valyrian steel blade, Longclaw. Since Jorah was convicted of slaving, like I mentioned, he had to leave Westeros, but it also brought shame among his family, and that's why Jorah Mormont converted the pommel on the sword from a bear to a wolf and gave it to Jon Snow instead. I don't really know if this is going to be a problem per se, but obviously Jorah would have been affected by his father being shamed by his actions. Then, like I said before, Gendry wanted to be a member of the Brotherhood Without Banners, if you remember that period of time. He kind of found his place with them, and he was really kind of on board with having a purpose almost, you know, and then they kind of screwed him over behind his back and just sold him off to Melisandre, so he has a chip on his shoulder about this. This is also going to be a problem because she's the same religion as they are. So even if they hadn't sold him to her, he probably still wouldn't like them as they're connected to that belief. The other one I mentioned was Tormund already doesn't like Jorah because of being the son of Jorah Mormont, who as the Night's Watch commander basically hunted down Tormund's people. Now, it went both ways, of course, but he says they hunted them like animals, and that is a true statement. Otherwise, Jorah is a knight, so I think his connection to the Greyjoy Rebellion actually makes him all right with Thoros and Beric. I don't think they would have any problem with him. This also probably would be helpful with Gendry as well. He fought as a knight under Robert Baratheon. So there's a lot of stuff going on under the surface with this group of guys, and I think that we're definitely due for a death, or as I said, possibly multiple deaths. A lot of people have speculated that maybe Gendry dies in the battle because we see that the Hound may be using his hammer later on, and like I said in my trailer breakdown, I don't think that's going to happen so fast, but it could. I think the general consensus is Thoros and Beric are the two most vulnerable. I feel like the Hound's pretty safe, because he sort of had that thing earlier in the season where his purpose might be a lot more than we expected, so I can't really see how that plays out right here. If he sees visions in the flame, that could definitely be useful, so why give him that power just to kill him off a couple episodes later? I had thought after the fact that maybe Tormund might be a good candidate to die because he's a fan favorite. And he's really not that important for anything except for his fighting prowess. I mean, there is the thing with Brienne where they kind of have them as a possible couple, but I'm not sure if that's enough to keep him around. But yeah, beyond that, I just don't see Gendry dying. So I think that the Lord of Light guys are the most likely, but I'll be interested to see what you guys think. It's pretty crazy when you think about how opposed these characters are to each other. I mean, like, the Hound actually killed Beric before. I guess there's no hard feelings about that since he came back to life, but there could be some shenanigans involved with that. People might die and get brought back. We do have Thoros, who has brought back Beric, and we know that Beric has the Kiss of Life that he passed on to Lady Stoneheart in the books, so that could come up. But yeah, this is a lot to think about. If you've already seen it, don't pretend like you haven't seen it and look at what's going on. I want to hear from people who are waiting and what they think's going to happen. That's where the fun is. After the episode actually airs, we'll talk all about it. So everybody play nice. Please like this video if you enjoyed it. Please subscribe to my channel if you haven't already and set your notifications there so that you'll see my new videos when they come out. Follow me on Twitter, Instagram, and on my Facebook page. Thanks for watching, guys. I'll talk to you soon.